Well, let's have a prayer before we begin the song service. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your blessings throughout this week and for bringing us here safely this Sabbath to worship you, Lord. Be with us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's open our hymnal to number 469, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Let my right get closer. Praise the Lord. Our next song will be number 468, A Child of the King. 468, which is just the next page to your left.
Oh,
Do you believe you're a child of the King?
Amen.
Amen. Well, let's sing it like we mean it. Last dance, number four. Praise the Lord. May you all have a blessed Sabbath.
Thank you so much for bringing us here this morning. Of all the places in the earth that you could be right now, Lord, where men are gathered doing important things or great things, you chose to be here in this humble church. And that just amazes us, Lord, just touches our hearts. We ask, Lord, that your Holy Spirit may be within our hearts, that your holy angels may be with us right now, that you may bless every act that will be done here, Lord, the children, the pastor, the choir, even us, Lord, who are going to be here listening to your word. We ask all of this in your name. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath to everyone. I'd like to welcome you all to the Chula Vista Seventh-day Adventist Church, and I'd like to welcome all those who are listening to us online also, and a special welcome to all of our visitors this morning. We have a few announcements for you. Next week is going to be our communion service, and I have a special announcement for the deaconesses. They would be aware of that and be aware of their duties that go along with that. And Edna is going to text the deaconesses with specific instructions for that. And going along with that, there's going to be no potluck fellow in the fellowship hall next Sabbath due to the communion service. And if anyone is interested in coordinating a potluck at the park next Sabbath, they would contact either Dr. Green or Auntie Cindy. And that would be most appreciated to have someone host that if possible. And of course, our potluck today, if any of your guests or regular attenders would like to come and eat with us, we have a really nice setup for that. And we have an announcement from the pastor this morning.
Thank you so much. I'm going to put up a video on the screen for you all. This summer, we're going to embark on two programs, and one is dealing with our workshops for our parents that are going to be dealing with financial planning and also career planning. And so if you know someone that's looking for a job or looking to transition, we have flyers in the back. Here's our flyer for it right here, our poster. And this is our Summer Bridge program. If someone that you know of is in a financial bind or is looking to try to figure out how to get their family on track, we want to help be a resource this summer for them. At the same time, we're going to be having a VBS program that'll be running for the kids, and we need some more volunteers for that. And so I want to just show you the program, just a little bit of it. I won't show you the whole clip. And this is put on by Voice of Prophecy. And so I'm going to let Jan or Jean let you know a little bit more about it here.
Really excited about. Now, a few years ago, we launched an audio program called Discovery Mountain. And in Discovery Mountain, we exercise our faith daily and listeners draw closer to Jesus. Now, the goal of everything that we do here at VOP is evangelism. And so we asked ourselves, how can this children's audio program help your church minister to families in your community? Well, the answer, a vacation Bible school program. And so, Rescued Safe in Jesus was born. Now, this VBS program takes place in Discovery Mountain at the fall camp, and it features characters that kids have already grown to love on the audio program. And the Bible story, as you can probably tell from this gorgeous artwork, is Noah and the flood. And at the end of the VBS, the kids will leave knowing that Jesus will keep them safe in Him. Now, you might be wondering what criteria we use to create this new resource. Well, first, it was important to us that we match the quality that you've come to expect from other VBS programs. Quality in music, ease of use, and video production standards specifically. And secondly, we were compelled to take this VBS just a little bit deeper spiritually than the typical VBS does. So, how have we met these criteria of quality and spiritual depth? Well, Rescued Safe in Jesus is set in a fall camp, and we created 9 original songs for the VBS. We shot the music videos on location at beautiful Glacier View Ranch right here in Colorado. And the music? Well, the music is fun and it's uplifting. And the production quality? Well, it's first rate. And we kept each of our churches in mind. We created a contemporary and a traditional version of every song. You pick the style that matches your group. Now, each day's VBS program begins with the exciting video story, Rescued at Fall Camp. These short videos play at the beginning and the end of each day's program, and they tell the story of campers caught in a potential flash flood. The camp setting is fun and friendly, and it's visually just gorgeous.
All right, we're going to stop right there. So we're going to be able to have a really neat VBS program, great put together, very well put together. And if you would like to be a part of it, we need group leaders for the kids. If you're a teen and would love to be able to be one of our group leaders to lead the kids around, if you want to work at one of our stations, we have a Bible story station, we're going to have a craft station, we're going to have several different stations, a snack station, a game station. If you would like to help be security or help with the main program and be a song leader, In the back, you'll see a sign-up sheet. Put your name on there and some of the areas that you would like to help in. It'll be Tuesday evenings from 6:30 to 8 p.m. If you're going to be on vacation for some of those weeks that we're going to have it, it'll be for 5 weeks. It's okay. If you can at least come to two or three of them, we would love to have you on the team. Thank you so much for considering and letting us know if you'd like to be a part. Also today, our deaconesses, we have a meeting right after church in the boardroom. So looking forward to seeing you all there.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. I'm glad to announce today that we have Investiture for Advemture. At this moment, I'd like to ask you to get your attentions to the back there. The Advemture are coming in, and they will sing Advemture song. You can help us with the song.
Adventures, at home, at school, and play, we are adventures. We're learning every day to be happy, fun, and true, to be like Jesus, true and true. We are adventures, we are adventures. At home, at school, and play, we are adventures. We're learning.
Okay, this is our team of adventures, and at this moment I'd like them to recite their pledge. Okay, adventures, attention, start, begin. Okay, adventures, can you say the adventures law? Respectful, be attentive, be helpful, be cheerful, be thoughtful, be reverent. Okay, we will have the opening prayer by Sky at this moment.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Please help the children who are sick and don't have a home. And please help the homeless people to be blessed. Please help the people who are going to come to have a safe drive over here. And thank you for everyone that is here. And please help everyone to know about you, God, because we want to go to heaven with you. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen.
The scripture reading will be on Judges 16:23-25 by Adriel.
Then the Lord of the Philistines gathered them together for to offer a great sacrifice unto Dagon their God, and to rejoice, for they said, "Our God hath delivered Samson our enemy into our hand. And when the people saw him, they praised their God, for they said, "Our God hath delivered into our hands our enemy and the destroyer of our country, which slew many of us." And it came to pass, when their hearts were merry, that they said, "Call for Samson, that he may make us sport." And they called for Samson out of the prison house, and he made them sport, and they set him between the pillars.
Amen.
Okay, at this moment, the Advemture will sing a song, "I've Got Peace Like a River."
Time for the children's offering, the lamb's offering, I mean. And as they do that, we're going to have a slide presentation of the Advemture. So if you have your offering, please raise your hand high so the children can see. Okay, I see a couple of hands over here. And I need someone to hold the basket for me. Who can hold the basket for me here? You want to hold it for me? We have some offering up here on the front. Thank you. And now is the time that we can participate with our offerings. The offering today is going to the Pine Spring Ranch. And as we celebrate the adventures here, we have Oshkosh coming up this year for the Pathfinders. We have one of our own, Josh Sevick, who is working at PSR. So we're reminded that our church is investing a lot in the youth. And let's do ourselves the same. I want to invite the deacons to come forward so that we can pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I want to thank you so much for bringing us here today, as we said before. We want to ask you, Lord, that you may bless the offering that was given earlier to the children and the offering that is going to be given now, that you may use this money, Lord, in a mighty way to bring others to you. In the name we pray, amen.
Morning, church. At this time, we are going to have our graduates honored on graduation Sabbath. And if you are a graduate here today, I would like you to stand right now. If you're here and you graduated this year in any level, kindergarten, sixth grade, eighth grade, high school, college, go ahead and stand. Amen. Amen. We're so excited for each and every one of you. We are so proud of each and every one of you. And we want to have just a little bit of an honoring of you today. You can be seated. What I'm going to do is call up each class of graduates at a time. And so I want to invite, first of all, Nancy Kessler to come up to present our kindergarten graduates. What we have for you here is a plaque that has a certificate in it, and it says, Chula Vista Seventh-day Adventist Church, Certificate of Achievement. We honor your name, and then for successfully completing this stage in your educational journey. We celebrate your hard work and perseverance. Your church family is praying for you as you continue on life's journey with God. And we pray for you and celebrate you in this achievement. We also have a little gift card to give you as well to enjoy at Jamba Juice. At this time, I'm going to have the teacher of kindergarten to read the two names of those that are graduating today. So, Nancy.
All right, first of all, I want to read the name of the kindergartners, Levi Callow, to come up. And the other kindergartner we have is Colin Peoples. Where's Colin?
Thank you so much, Nancy. At this time, I'm going to invite Jim Rapp to come up to read both the names of our sixth grade graduates and our eighth grade graduates. And we'll do the same thing again. I want to thank you for your leadership in our junior early teen class. Thank you so much, Mr. Rapp.
From sixth grade, we have Jazlyn De Armas. We have Jacqueline Lopez. And Christian Peoples. From our eighth grade class, we have Kiara Mae Lackendunham. And we have Emma Williams.
At this time, we have our 12th grade graduation, and I was going to have James, but I will do it and fill in for James today as our youth teacher. I also was the youth teacher this year, too. So at this time, let me just get these out. If your child isn't here, but you are here as a parent, please come down and get their gift. We have Cody Brady. Is Cody here or his family? All right. We also have Omar Caro, and we have Mr. Rapp here representing for that. We have Julia Felix, who's at Youth Rush right now. And can we have a parent to represent for hers? Dr. Felix is right behind me, yes. We're so proud of her. We also have Anna Elizabeth Macedo as well. We want to honor you, Anna. Congratulations. We also have Xander Myong.
Xander's going to be going to La Sierra next year, so we're going to miss you, but we're proud of you. Proud of you. Praise God. All right. We also have Joshua Sevick, who is working at PSR camp right now, and so I want to ask his father to come down. We're proud of Josh going to Walla Walla and a part of the Air Force. Amen. All right. At this time, we have a few more names, and I'm going to invite Miss Myung, Stephanie Myung, to come up and read them for us today. Psychology. Hey, psychology. Yeah.
We'd like to recognize Raylene DeArmas with a teacher's credential. Next, David Morgan with a Bachelor's of Science in Psychology. Next is our own Pastor William Penick with a Master's in Divinity. And last of all, Timothy Williams with a Bachelor in Science of Engineering, or in Engineering.
Thank you again, all the teachers that played a role in our Sabbath school classes. Thank you, parents, for what you did to sacrifice to help them get there. And thank you, graduates, for what you did to continue and persevere in your studies and make it. May God continue to bless you on this journey. At this time, we have our teachers and parents recognition from our adventurers.
It's a pleasure for me to work with Advemture, the little kids, even though I don't have little kids. My daughter is going to college and my son is in 10th grade. But I love working with the little kids. It's so amazing to see their smile, their happiness when we do the activities for them. It's all for them. It's for them to learn about Jesus and having fun. So at this moment, I like to recognize our teachers, because without them, I couldn't do this. So please, teachers, all our, my teachers, stand up, please. Thank you so much for your help. And also the parents, because if you don't bring your kids here, so we don't have adventures. Please, parents, stand up. All the parents and parents and teachers are also, they are also parents and teachers too. Thank you so much. At this moment, we'd like to recognize the kids because during the year they worked on awards. They worked on activities, then they get awards for that. So I like to call their names, and I need help from Irene. Irene will give the sash to them, and the sash has all the awards they got during the year. Some kids are collecting from past years, so you see a sash that is full of awards. And also Angie will give the clasping. Okay, I'd like, maybe you guys could go in there in the middle. I think it's better than everybody can see. Okay, I'd like to call Olivia. Olivia is an active aunt. Daniel is a little lamb. Jacob is also a little lamb. Fernie just started, so he didn't acquire any award yet, but he is part of the club already. Mercedes is a busy bee. Sky is a busy bee also. She also just started. Levi is an eager beaver. Liam is also an eager beaver. Nicole is a sunbeam. Adriel is a builder. Hannah is a helping hand. Hannah, can you stay here, please? Because Hannah is a helping hand is the last class. So she is graduating from Advemture. And I'd like to ask Mr. Rapp to come up here, because he is one of the leaders for Pathfinders. So she's moving to Pathfinders now. Congratulations, Hannah. Thank you, Mr. Rapp. Okay, at this moment, I'd like to ask all the Advemture to come. To come up here, to come right there, to sing the song. I'm sorry. It's Hannah. It's only Hannah. Sorry. It's only Hannah. She will sing a song for us. Wanna be here? Or there? Right here.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before me. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, well, no turning back. Will you decide now to follow Jesus? Will you decide now to follow Jesus? Will you decide now to follow Jesus? No turning back, no turning back.
Amen. Thank you, Hannah, for leading us in that beautiful song, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. Amen. Adventurers, it was a blessing to be a part of your investiture today. I look at all of the work that you all have accomplished this year or in the past years, and that you're wearing on your sash. And I'm so proud of each and every one of you and what you've done. I'm so thankful for all of our parents and staff that have made this year a successful year. And it's a blessing to just share this morning a few words. Today's message is an adventure in and of itself. What we're going to do is we're going to follow a chiastic structure. We're going to begin with our kids right here, our adventurers, and then we're going to move into our youth, young adults, and young professionals, and then we're going to move up to our middle-aged and seniors, move back down to our youth and young adults, and close out with our kids. So our message today is entitled, An Adventure Awaits. An Adventure Awaits. Would you bow your heads with me? Dear Heavenly Father, this morning we pray that your word would be edified. We pray that we would be lifted up to you in heaven, and that we might have our hearts draw closer to you. May we also be challenged by the words of Scripture and be reminded of the areas in which we can improve and grow closer to you. We pray that today we would continue to remember that you have a path and a purpose and a plan for us, and that an adventure still awaits. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's an old saying that goes this way. Life is what you make it. So why can't life be an adventure? If anyone's life began as an adventure, Samson's did. Samson's parents, you see, could not have any children. They would never have known what it was to have a little boy, and they never thought they would name him Samson. One day, his parents were visited by an angel. In fact, it was the angel of the Lord, and the angel of the Lord was not any ordinary angel. The angel of the Lord was God himself. It was a theophany. It was the second person of the Godhead coming in the form of an angel. Samson's story began before he was born. God came and told his parents that they were going to have a special boy. They were given special instructions. He wasn't to cut his hair. He wasn't to drink any alcohol, and he was to be set apart. He was given a name, and his name was Samson, and Samson meant and still means today son. Isn't it interesting? See, God was going to use him on an adventure to be a bright light in his community. The Bible says in Judges chapter 13, would you turn with me there? Judges chapter 13, verses 14 and 15. Judges chapter 13, verses 14 and 15. Say amen when you get there. Amen. All right. Wait a little bit longer. Say amen when you get there. Amen. So it starts out by addressing Samson's mom. And it says, so the woman bore a son and called his name Samson. And the child grew, and the Lord blessed him, and the Spirit of the Lord began to move upon him. I'm going to pause there. The Spirit of the Lord began to move upon him. See, Samson was born. How many of you all are already born? Can I see your hands, adventurers? You guys are born, all right? And he began to develop as a child in his purpose. The Bible says that God's Spirit rested upon Samson. Samson was able to do great things for God because God was with him. Samson became one of the strongest men to ever walk the earth. Adventurers, are you an adventurer? Raise your hand, adventurers. Kindergarten graduates, did you graduate from kindergarten, anyone? Children, God is calling you on a journey, on an adventure. There is, you know, right now, plenty of fun time, and you get a chance to hang out with friends, and you have to do a little bit of homework. But, you know, for the most part, your parent or parents make sure you have all of your needs provided for. You've got clothes to wear. You've got food to eat. You have most of your not only needs but also your wants taken care of too. But your life is still an adventure. You are preparing for your future, and it starts not someday, but it has already begun. God has a plan for you, a purpose for you. You are loved, you are special, and you are chosen just like Samson in our story today. God has a special calling for you, young people. He wants you to be a light in your community. He wants you to shine for Jesus by how you live, how you love, and how you act. He has special instructions for you, and they are found right here in the Bible. As you follow God's word, they will help you stay connected with God on your journey. All right, adventurers, kids, I'm going to come back to you all, okay, in just a little bit. But right now I'm going to move up to our youth and young adults. I'm going to say something in this section that you won't quite understand, and it's okay. But we're going to come back to it at the end. And at the very end, you all will tell us the closure of our message today, and it's going to be really great. Now, the thing about an adventure in a perfect world is that everywhere you go and everything that you do is safe and is good for you to do. But we don't live in that kind of world, right? We live in a world in which there is good, better, and best, bad, worse, and worst. Samson grew up in this broken, imperfect world. He knew what it was to have success. Guys, he was a young man in his prime. And when I say prime, I'm not talking about being able to leap 10 feet off of his feet and dunk a basketball. I'm talking about he literally took a lion and tore it with his bare hands in half. Samson was strong. I mean, he made strong look like the new weak. He was that strong. Now, another time he was taken with his arms tied up and led toward the Philistines. And as he got up to them and they were going to capture him, he broke completely outside of his ropes and took a donkey's jawbone and began to swing around and around until 1,000 enemy Philistines lay at the bottom of the ground after they took those hits from his jawbone. This was better than the Matrix. This was better than any Marvel character, and this was actually real life. It wasn't in a comic. Samson also knew what it was, though, to make poor choices. The issue was that Samson also pursued what made him feel good. He thought that whatever pleased him, catch this, would make him happy. Samson chose the woman that he decided to marry by one criteria only. She looked good. His parents tried to reason with him. You know, they didn't think that they would make a good match. They didn't have the same values. They didn't grow up in the same kind of home. They didn't share the same kind of faith. But all that mattered to Samson is that when he looked at her, he was like, yeah, that's who I want to be my wife. Samson thought that what made him feel good would make him happy. But that's not necessarily true. And Samson learned this the hard way. I want you to see the story unravel quite quickly. It says, and I'm not going to read it from the Bible, I'm going to tell it to you. He goes to this wedding feast, it's his own wedding, and he decides to give a riddle for a bet. And whoever loses that bet is going to have to pay a lot of clothes. The guys at the wedding feast don't want to pay all these clothes, and so they threaten his wife to tell them the answer or they would kill her family. His wife begins to nag and beg him to give her the answer, but never told Samson that she was in trouble. See, they already had trust issues. She couldn't even tell Samson that her family was going to be murdered. But finally, she wore down Samson, and Samson began to give her the answer. She, in turn, tells the answer to the men, and the men, in turn, tell the answer to Samson. And Samson realizes that his wife has betrayed him, and he storms out of his wedding furious. While Samson is gone and just brooding over all the things that had happened, his wife's father marries her off to one of the men that had tried to kill her if she didn't get the answer to Samson's riddle. Man, I feel sorry for Samson's wife. Samson comes back and asks for his wife, and the father says, hey, I've already given her away to someone else. So what does Samson do? Samson captures 300 foxes, ties their tail together, and then sets each pair afire. 150 foxtails go traveling through all of the crops of the Philistines, burning them completely to the ground. And finally, the Philistines are angry, and they say, who did this? And they are told that Samson did. In retaliation, they kill Samson's ex-wife and all of her family. You can't make this stuff up. This is in the Bible. Samson chose a wife based off of her looks alone, and instead of a happy ever after marriage, he had a short-lived one full of nagging, begging, anger, frustration, disappointment, and death. This world tells us that our brand to find our own brand of happiness, and this idea was recognized in the birth of our very own nation within our Declaration of Independence, life, liberty, and the pursuit of what? Happiness. The thing is that God wants us to be happy. The issue is our misconception of what happiness is. Many times we are tempted to feel that whatever we want is what will make us happy. To my sixth grade, eighth grade, high school, college graduates, you have a lot of choices out there in front of you. The world is changing and it's challenging. You can choose an adventure like Samson where whatever looks good to you, you do. I mean, people say it this way, do you. Or they say it this way, YOLO. You only live once, right? Do it your way, whatever makes you feel good. But the thing is, putting in your body whatever makes you feel good can have short-term and long-term effects against your happiness. Alcohol and even the newly legalized marijuana can feel good at first, but getting a DUI on your record or cirrhosis of the liver when you get older won't bring you happiness. We are just beginning to learn some of the side effects of what an extended use of marijuana is doing. One of the short-term effects emergency rooms are finding out are patients are walking in with extreme vomiting and nausea, and they can't stop. The crazy thing is that medical marijuana is prescribed in order to get rid of nausea, and yet people that are using it for pleasure are taking too much and it's causing them nausea. They thought they were going to find happiness, but unfortunately they found an emergency room. We are living in a world where everyone is recreating and self-naming. Everyone is the master of their own universe, their own story, their own adventure. Changing how they look through cosmetic surgeries, changing how they are through gender, changing who they would be biologically attracted to. There are so many options, so many choices, and it's so close to home. We have family, we have friends, or we probably at least know someone who has chosen to live this way. This month in San Diego, it's Pride Month. And Pride Month is the celebration of a minority group who has decided not to be ashamed of what makes them different within the norms of sexuality. But my question is this: is defining oneself by sexuality truly lead to happiness? Does chasing of pleasure truly make one happy? It's easy to think my body is my own. I can do whatever I want with it. But if we live that way, and if we do that, we're going to find ourselves missing out on the adventure that God has for us. Instead of a short-lived good time like Samson had with his wife, God wants to take us on an adventure that will last a lifetime. I'm going to come back to this. Before we do, we're going to continue on this chiastic structure. Samson chose God's adventure for 20 years. For 20 years, Samson was faithful. For 20 years, Samson was focused. For 20 years, he settled into judging the people of Israel as God had ordained and called him to do. But then he hit that midlife crisis. He was around 40, 45 years old, and he decided to start pursuing again what he thought was going to make him happy. He started dating this woman named Delilah. You might have heard of her before. She made him feel young again. She pleased him. He was super attracted. I can only imagine the emojis that they were sharing on if they had iPhones back in their day. Again, the Philistines, though, used a person Samson was going after for happiness against him. Each Philistine lord promised to give her 1,100 pieces of silver if she was able to find out what made Samson beyond humanly strong. If there were 10 lords, imagine this, she would have gotten 11,000 pieces of silver. If it was 20 lords, she would have been given 22,000 pieces of silver. However many lords there were and however much money she could have gotten, Delilah thought that the money she was going to get was going to make her more happy than being with Samson. So she decides to get rid of Samson for the money. She began to nag Samson for his secret. She would keep saying, "Samson, please tell me what makes you so strong," with her pouty face. "Samson, please, please." Finally, Samson got tired of all of her begging and all of her nagging and all the things that she kept asking. And he says, "Fine, let me tell you." And he would make up a fake reason as to why he was so strong. And then Delilah would begin to pout again because it didn't work. I don't know how Samson didn't figure out, right? I mean, we always ask this question. Why does Samson keep giving her answers and she keeps testing out on him and he keeps giving her more answers? Eventually, Samson gets so worn down that he says, "In order to make you quiet, I'm going to tell you the secret." And he tells her the secret. The next thing Samson knows is that he's found himself head shaven, blinded, bound, and unable to fight back when Delilah calls in the Philistines to come fight him. It brings us back to our text this morning. Turn with me to Judges chapter 16. Samson had been working the mill as a prisoner of the Philistines. After some time, he was brought out as a comedy act in routine. He was brought out to be entertainment to the Philistine lords. The old warrior that had brought them so much grief was now unable to do it anymore. They laughed at what had happened to him. They laughed at who he had become. They laughed because they saw how the roles had reversed. They used to tremble in fear for him, and now they saw him trembling up there on that stage in the temple. Judges 16, verses 25 and 26. Let's look at what it says. So it happened that when their hearts were merry, they said, "Call for Samson, that he may perform for us." So they called for Samson from the prison, and he performed for them. They stationed him between the pillars. And then Samson said to the lad who held him by the hand, "Let me feel the pillars which support the temple, so that I can lean on them." Samson's life was full of regrets. He had been physically strong, but spiritually and morally weak. But Samson realized something. See, even when you haven't lived up to your potential, even when you've made so many mistakes in your life, life can still be an adventure. Samson cried out to the Lord, continuing on, "O Lord, God, remember me, I pray. Strengthen me, I pray, just this once. O God, that I may with one blow take vengeance on the Philistines for my two eyes." And Samson took a hold of the two pillars which supported the temple. He braced himself against them, one on his right and the other on his left. And then Samson said, "Let me die with the Philistines." And he pushed with all of his might, and the temple fell on the Lord's and all the people who were in it. And the Bible says these words, "So the dead that he killed at his death were more than what he had killed in his life." Today, some of you are looking back on your life with some regrets. Things you wish you could go back and change. Others of you, the change is with your body. You're getting more aches and pains. I mean, I can't even go out and play basketball like I used to. I feel like, you know, I feel like a train wreck the next day. Seeing people that you love and know slipping away into Alzheimer's and dementia. Seeing people that were so amazing now no longer able to remember certain memories. It can be frightening as we get older, wondering, man, what's left to live and hope for in life? When you look in the mirror and what stares back at you isn't the same picture you saw when you were 20 or 18. However, Samson wants to remind us that even as we get older, to still grab the pillars. To step into what God has for us, to not settle, to not go into the night quietly. There is still a work to do. Amen? There is still an adventure that awaits. With God, nothing is impossible. No matter our age or limitations, God can and will still use us. Amen? Coming back to our young people, you can decide to live like Samson, or you can learn from Samson. You don't have to wait until the end of your life to fulfill your purpose. You don't need to have your story say you accomplished more by your death than your life. You and I are living, and with this gift of life, we can use it for God. Amen? One of my professors put it this way. He said, borrowing from another theologian, "God loves in freedom and limits his freedom by love." God's adventure is one that loves freely, unconditionally, that does not hold back, that embraces all that God has provided for us in this life. At the same time, God limits his love or his freedom by the boundary of love, by the boundary of relationships. This is his law. We are free to do anything that does not hurt God, ourselves, or others. A freedom that has the boundary of love, the choices I choose to live by, puts God first, doesn't lie, doesn't steal, doesn't commit adultery, remembers the Sabbath, and honors my parents. God's boundaries protect relationships. When we chase after happiness above or beyond these boundaries, we will find our lives more broken and less whole, more pained and less happy, more coping and less living. I know the new ethic is not this. The new ethic of our day is tolerance. If I don't agree with your lifestyle, then don't say anything about it. Let me do me. But the question I have today is that love? If I am concerned with your true happiness, can I just tolerate something that is going to not bring you happiness? Something that in the end is going to bring you pain. I remember when Connie and I went to my sister's wedding in Atlanta. It was beautiful and it was hot. It was humid in Atlanta. And that weekend after the wedding, I think maybe the day after the weekend, it was Monday, we went to this gorgeous park. It was beautiful. It was really big, and there were some nice botanical gardens and all kind of things out there. But they were also hosting a big pride fair, and everybody had their booths out, and everybody was there. And as Connie and I are walking around, noticing the nature, but also noticing everything around us, I'm wrestling with my thoughts. What do I feel as a Christian? What do I feel as a Christian young man when I know people that are in this lifestyle? I know people that that are my friends or that are even family. What do I say? What do I do in spaces like this? And as I was wrestling with it, I heard God telling me to love. What would happen if the church was the church to those who were outside of it? To love people that we see as different or other. Many of them were hurt by their parents when they came out. Many of them felt like the church was only an institution that judged them. On the other side, though, love shouldn't be traded for silence. If I love you, my thoughts and feelings shouldn't be silenced to just tolerate. I should never be derogatory, bullying, or unempathetic, but that doesn't mean I can't share God's plans or purposes for true happiness. That God-sized holes in our hearts won't be fixed through self-naming or exploring sexuality beyond God's design. As we face a new legislation in the Equality Act, it is right now before the Judicial Committee. We should be writing our senators and share what God is putting on our hearts. I want to encourage you to do so, but I want to encourage you to do so with a Christ-like spirit. I want you to send emails sharing what you feel God has put on your heart. And I'm going to be sending out an email this week just to share some of the ways that that can happen, ways that you can contact senators. Being brave to shine a light as the world moves further away from God's Advemture is what is needed today. I know that many of you are already doing so. I think of musical Xander, talented in many other areas, always ready to share when someone asks. I asked him to be the MC for our VBS, and he said yes. Josh, who always had the dream to be an Air Force pilot, is beginning that dream as he goes to Walla Walla for engineering as an Air Force recruit. He's going to be a much needed voice in that world. Raylene is bringing a much needed influence into the classroom as a teacher. Emma is already such a great mentor to kids younger than her, always volunteering to help and giving gifts to the little ones, including my little daughter. Emma's like a big sister to Ariella. I got a couple of letters, and I meant to bring them out last week. And they had our address on the outside. And when I opened them, they had a glow track and a handwritten note. And I noticed that it was signed by a Lisa Marie. I was wondering if this could be our very own Lisa Marie, the one who sings up here from time to time and graces us with her voice. I asked her last week if they were from her, and she shyly admitted, yes, they were. See, what she had decided to do was to write handwritten notes to her neighbors, and she inserted a glow track. and she dropped it off in people's homes. And two of her neighbors decided to drop them into the mailbox. Without a postage, it somehow arrived here at our church. And Jeanette said, "Will, do you think there's money in here?" Because it was in a Spanish tithe envelope. I said, "I don't think it's money." But it was even better. It was a witness from one of our young people to her neighbors. These young people are joining God on an adventure. And when you stay with God, you will live with less regrets. Life won't always be exciting. There will be waiting periods. But ultimately, you will live a more fulfilled and happy life. Now here we are at the end. We made it. Back to the kids. You guys get to remind us an important part of Scripture. Jesus said, "Unless we become like little children, we won't enter the kingdom of heaven." So what I want us to do as we think about the adventure of life from all of its stages, from beginning, middle, and end, and wherever we are on that spectrum, let's always have a childlike heart. Let's always allow God to open our eyes to see the world through the eyes of a child. And at this time, we're going to put up a video that's going to show two questions. The first, what the adventurers love best about their year. And the second question is going to be this, simply, who do you love?
Sucking on a straw like you're drinking something, but like kind of drinking a bead. My mom.
Awesome. Mercedes.
The thing that I like about adventures is learning about God. I love you, God.
Charlie. Play.
Bernie.
Love you. The water. The jumper.
You can help me for a lot. Mom, I love you.
Oh, yes, I'm ready. So my favorite thing to do in adventures is when we get to watch a video. Like, I like to watch a kindness video on TV. I love you, Mom.
Okay. I like going camping, spending time with my friends, when I adventures. I also like having these meetings and church service, greeting, and everything that we do in adventures.
Okay.
I also love my mom and my dad.
Doing projects and making lions and playing with lions, playing with tigers. I love my teacher.
I love my teacher so much.
I like to hang out
my friend is Jacob.
Let's bow our heads for the benediction. Dear Lord, I want to thank you so much for this time that we've had with the adventurers. And I thank you for each adventurer. I thank you for each graduate. And I thank you for each parent who has helped the adventurer and the graduate to get to where they are today. But Lord, may they continue to use their lives to bless others. And may they use their lives to bless you, Father, and witness for you of the things that they know and the things that they are looking forward to, of being in heaven with you, Father. So we ask that you would go with us, that we would always put God first in our hearts and in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.